Good morning. I hope you had a wonderful Thanksgiving with your family, spending time together this week. You know, we had a great Thanksgiving. We spent it with my wife's family. They actually live just right here in Schaumburg down Roselle Road, and we had a great time. Is that yours?
Nope.
Okay. The thing that happens always every year at Thanksgiving happened again this year for me. I ate too much. I overate. It just kind of happens. Is anyone else in the same boat with me? What happens on Thanksgiving where this is just, it just happens? You have a nice plate of Thanksgiving food, the turkey and the mashed potatoes and the stuffing, and especially the cranberry sauce. You can never forget the cranberry sauce. And then you're full. But then they're like, we have dessert. And you're like, well, it would be rude of me not to eat the dessert. They baked it. And so you take a nice slice of pumpkin pie, you put it on your plate, you eat it, and you're like, that was really good, but I forgot to put whipped cream on it. So what if I went back and got another piece, slightly smaller, and put whipped cream on it? And you're like, that was a great decision. You eat that, and then you're like, well, they made other desserts too. I should probably try those as well. And then you're 9 plates in, and you're like, what happened? You feel like you're gonna explode. Someone has to roll you around the house for the rest of the day. Thanksgiving. It's a wonderful time. It is a wonderful time. And I love Thanksgiving. It's such a great season to stop, isn't it? To stop and to be thankful. To remember all of the things that the Lord has done in your life, in the life of your family, in the life of your friends. It's such a great season to stop and be thankful. And you know, I'm thankful for God's word this morning, and we're gonna jump right into it. Is that all right?
Jump.
All right, let's jump, okay. We're gonna be continuing in our series in Mark called Just Jesus, All Authority. And we've seen Jesus do some incredible things over the past 2 weeks. We have seen Jesus calm the storm, showing his absolute authority over nature. We've seen Jesus cast out the demons and show his absolute authority over demons. And this week, we are going to see his authority again. The title of the message today is Just Jesus, All Authority, Power Over Illness. And we're gonna be in Mark chapter 5, verse 21. We're gonna go all the way through the end of the chapter. But before we jump in, let me pray for us. God, we are thankful, Lord. We are thankful for this week, for this time that we have had with our family. Lord, we're thankful for all of the good gifts that you give to us. You are such a good God. You are so faithful to us. And so, Lord, we are thankful now to be opening your word, to be in your house, seeking after you. And so, Lord, would you engage our hearts and our minds as we seek after you in your word. Be with us as we spend time in your word together. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. We're gonna jump right into verse 21, Mark 5, verse 21. And when Jesus had crossed again in the boat to the other side, a great crowd gathered about him, and he was beside the sea. Here Jesus is again crossing the Sea of Galilee. That last trip, if you remember, wasn't a very long trip at all. Pastor Dave preached last week about Jesus crossing the sea, and immediately the demoniac man came out of the tombs, and Jesus cast the unclean spirits into some pigs, who then jumped off of a cliff and drowned in the water, which then led to one of the greatest Bible-based jokes that I've ever heard, that this moment in Scripture was the first documented case of the swine flu. That's gold. That's gold. I'm gonna use that. Thank you, Pastor Dave. But the people did not like the fact that Jesus just sent 2,000 of their pigs over the cliff. And so they asked Jesus to leave. And he did. He left. And now he's back on the other side, the side that he originally started on near Capernaum. And once again, he is surrounded by a crowd. Now, while we're going through the scripture today, we're gonna be building a small paragraph. We're gonna be building a small paragraph. And I would encourage you, if you're willing, to write this paragraph in the front or the back blank pages of your Bible. 2 weeks ago, I shared some verses that I have in the front of my Bible that have encouraged me greatly through times of trouble and trial. And I'm hoping and prayerful that this paragraph that we build together today is going to be helpful for you as well in times of trouble. And so the first thing that we're gonna see in the passage is that when I am feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, I will seek Jesus. When I'm feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, I will seek Jesus. We're going to see two stories that are sort of smashed together in the text of people with a crisis that is causing them to be desperate. And we're going to see how they seek after Jesus. The first one we meet is in verse 22. Then came one of the rulers of the synagogue, Jairus by name. And seeing him, he fell at his feet and implored him earnestly, saying, "My little daughter is at the point of death. Come and lay your hands on her so that she may be made well and live." And he went with him. First is Jairus, one of the rulers of the synagogues. Now, this wouldn't have been one of the religious leaders like the Pharisees or the scribes. This would have been a layperson who takes care of the synagogue. He would have been responsible for arranging various parts of the worship that happens in the synagogue. He would be in charge of facilitating all of the things behind the scenes. He wouldn't actually be the one up front performing the rituals in the worship time. He would be a layperson. And so here Jairus is, this leader, this ruler of the synagogue. He enters the scene amongst the crowd and walks up to Jesus. He says that his only daughter is dying. Says at the point of death, she has reached her end. She doesn't have long. And you can see and hear the desperation in his actions and in his words. He falls at the feet of Jesus and implores him earnestly. This is an intense and fervent plea. The word earnestly there means many times. This really shows his desperation, and maybe you've experienced this level of desperation before. God, please help me. God, please help me. God, please help me. You keep repeating the same thing over and over and over again out of desperation. That's what's happening here in the text. Needless to say, he is in crisis, and rightly so. He is desperate. And so he seeks Jesus amongst the crowd and urges him to come with him. And Jesus, in his great kindness and in his great love, does so. He goes with Jairus. And then as they're leaving to go to his house, we meet the second person that we're going to see in crisis, who is desperate, who is seeking Jesus. And a great crowd followed him and thronged about him, meaning they were pressing in to him. And there was a woman who had a discharge of blood for 12 years and who had suffered much under many physicians and had spent all that she had and was no better, but rather grew worse. She had heard the reports about Jesus and came up behind him in the crowd and touched his garment. Here, an unnamed woman who is suffering with a discharge of blood. We see, I'm not going to get graphic here, but I want to give us just enough to have some context around this. It was most likely a uterine hemorrhage. It could have been either a constant or periodic thing that was happening, but it was bad enough to cause weakness over long periods of time. And you can see her desperation in this crisis. It says that she suffered under many physicians. Now, the medical arts back then, if you know, were terrible. And so truly, she suffered under many physicians. And she had spent all that she had. She had spent all of her money trying to be healed, trying as hard as she could to be healed for 12 years. She tried everything. She spent everything, and nothing was helping. She was actually getting worse. She is desperate. Then she hears about Jesus, the reports of the miracles, the reports of Jesus, the man who is saying that he's the Son of God, these teachings. And so she abandons the path of physicians and seeks after Jesus. I love that this is both of their reactions to desperation. They both take their desperation to the right place. They both take their desperation to the right person. And far too often, we take our desperation to the wrong places. We seek after the wrong thing. In our desperation, we go to the wrong places. We go to the places of the world. Sometimes in our desperation, we go to places like isolation. We isolate ourselves. I don't know what to do anymore. I can't affect this situation. So I'm just gonna I'm just going to isolate myself. I don't want to be a burden on anyone else. I don't want to trouble anyone with my problems, with the things that I've got going on in my life. I want to suffer in silence. They bring their desperation to isolation. Some bring their desperation to addiction. There's nothing that I can do. And so I might as well feel good. I might as well try to numb the pain the best that I can. Some people take their desperation to their self. I can do this. I can push through. I don't need anyone's help. I can do it. I'm sufficient. I've got the power. I can do it. I can push through. I can make this right. If I just try harder, if I just give more money to it, if I just keep going. We bring our desperation to the wrong places. And we see in the text, these two, Jairus and this woman, they don't take their desperation there. They take their desperation to Jesus. They bring it straight to the right place. They are desperate and they seek after Jesus, and we need to do the same. We need to watch their example. We need to bring our desperation to Jesus because he hears you. Your desperation does not fall on deaf ears with Jesus. He hears you. Jairus brings his desperation, his pleas. Please help me. And Jesus hears him. You have that same access. Jesus hears you too. So bring your desperation to him. When I'm feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, I will seek Jesus. Here's the second thing. I will have the faith that leads to action by believing in his power. I will have the faith that leads to action by believing in his power. We see that both of these people had faith that led to action. They believed in the power of Jesus. We saw that Jairus had faith that Jesus could heal his daughter, so much so that he left his daughter's side as she was nearing the point of death. Not many fathers would do that. They would stay. And he went to where Jesus was. His faith in the power of Jesus led him to action. It led him to act and go to Jesus. He believed in the power of Jesus. And now we're going to see faith in action with the woman. Look at verse 28. For she said, if I touch even his garments, I will be made well. If I touch even his garments, I will be made well. She heard the reports and she had faith to believe that Jesus could heal her. And she believed that she could, if she could even just touch his garments, she could just touch him, she would be healed. Her faith led her to action, to go out to Jesus, to be close to him, to just touch him. And I think it's really important to understand her condition and her status in this moment, because I think that that shows her faith, truly accentuates her faith. You see, because of her bleeding problem, she would have been classified as unclean. She would have been classified as unclean. This was a big deal in these times. Those who were classified as unclean were shunned. They were isolated so that they wouldn't spread their uncleanness to other people. If she were to touch someone directly, skin to skin, they would be unclean. And they would have to go through purification rites that would last 7 days. If she touched someone indirectly by their clothes, if she sat in the same seat as them, if she touched the same object as them, any indirect contact, that person would be considered unclean for the rest of the day until they were able to wash themselves in the evening. And so she was taking a huge risk going into this crowd to seek after Jesus, because the people in that crowd would not take kindly to being touched even indirectly by this woman. So risking humiliation and judgment by these people, she snuck into the crowd. And she came up behind Jesus and she touched his garments. This was most likely the bottom of his garments. She would have been on her hands and knees reaching out and grabbing the bottom of Jesus' outer coat. Now this act that this woman does in the state that she's in of being unclean is actually forbidden by the law. But she has faith that even touching the garments of Jesus Christ is going to heal her. She had an incurable disease. And Jairus had his only daughter on the brink of death. These two were believing a lot on the power of Christ. You see, this woman, though, had faith in other things before she turned to Jesus. She had faith in physicians. She had faith in medicine. She had faith in money and wealth. But when she changed her faith to Jesus Christ, everything changed. You see, everyone has faith in something. Everyone does. When you get sick, some have faith in doctors. Some have faith in medicine. Some have faith in their own bodies to fight off the infection. Some have faith in essential oils, you know. Rub some eucalyptus on your foot. You'll be healed. Everyone has faith in something. When we turn on the faucet, we have faith that water is going to come out. Drinkable water, not sewage, not sludge. Drinkable water. You had faith when you sat in the seat that you sat in today that it would not break. You had faith that you would wake up this morning. You had faith that the sun would rise like it always does. You had faith that you would be safe as you drove into church. Everyone has faith in something. And that faith isn't always bad. Sometimes it makes perfect sense. But we need to be sure that our faith is first and foremost in Jesus Christ. He is the one who has all authority over all of these things. Our faith must first and foremost be in him. And we see this. When this woman changes her faith to Jesus Christ, everything changes. Look, watch, verse 29. And immediately the flow of blood dried up and she felt in her body that she was healed of her disease. Immediately the healing comes. There's the word, immediately. We see that a lot in the book of Mark. We're gonna see it a lot in this passage. Instantaneous. As soon as she touched his garment, healed. Healed of a disease that plagued her for 12 years. No doctor could help. No amount of money could help. Only Jesus. The authority of Jesus and his power over illness is on full display right here. He doesn't even need to say anything. He just heals her through his clothes. That is power. That is authority. Verse 30, and Jesus, perceiving in himself that power had gone out from him, immediately turned in the crowd and said, "Who touched my garments?" And his disciples said to him, "You see the crowd pressing around you, and yet you say, 'Who touched me?'" And he looked around to see who had done it. I love this. Jesus, perceiving his power go out. And then we see the word again. And immediately turned and said, "Who touched my garments?" He responds immediately. This shows the responsiveness of Jesus. He didn't just shrug it off and move on. He felt his healing power go out and he responds immediately. This is a great truth for you and for me, that when we reach out to Jesus in faith, he responds. When you reach out to Jesus in faith, he responds immediately. That's comforting. Jesus says, "Who touched my garments?" I love the disciples' answer. "Yeah, of course someone touched you, Jesus. We're in a crowd. Everyone's touching everyone right now. Everyone's pushing," like Captain Obvious moment. Then he looks around to see who had done it. Who had done it there? That phrase is actually a feminine participle, literally translating, he looked around to see the woman who had done it. Verse 33, but the woman, knowing what had happened to her, came in fear and trembling and fell down before him. This is reverence. And told him the whole truth. She confessed everything to Jesus. And he said to her, "Daughter, your faith has made you well. Go in peace and be healed of your disease." Jesus affectionately places an identity onto this woman. He calls her daughter. And this is significant because this is the only time in the New Testament that Jesus refers to a female by this title, daughter. And he says that your faith has made you well. Literally translated, your faith has saved you. The word for made well there is sozo. It means saved. Sozo. Your faith has saved you. Because when sozo, this word, is used in conjunction with faith, it doesn't mean just a physical healing is happening. It means a spiritual healing is happening as well. Her faith not only physically healed her, it spiritually healed her. Her faith made her a spiritual child of God. That's why Jesus calls her daughter, as well as a physically healed person. Two miracles are really happening here at the same time. This woman is being healed physically, and she is being saved. Salvation is happening. She believed in his power. She believed that he was who he said he was. And her faith was activated to go and to reach out to Jesus. Sometimes it's hard to believe in the power of Jesus. Typically, when we're going through something difficult, it's hard to believe in the power of Christ. And so I wrote down just three things that helped me believe in his power, especially when going through a crisis. The first one, of course, we have to start with the gospel. It's the gospel. Believe in him. You can't believe in his power if you don't believe in him. It has to start with believing in him, believing that he is who he says he is, that he has done what he said he has done, that he is the perfect Son of God, that he lived the perfect life, that he died the death that we deserved on the cross for our sin, and was raised again 3 days later, defeating sin and death, and ascending into heaven to sit at the right hand of God, ruling and reigning. And his gift to us, eternal life, changed life now, he gives to those who believe in him. Believe in his power. First, you have to believe in him. Second, remember his works. This is something that helps me when I'm struggling in this area. Just look back on your life. Look back and see the works that Jesus did in your life. Your salvation. The moment that he changed you. That he saved you. That he transformed you. That he gave you a new path. A new eternity. A new purpose. And then think back to all of the things that he has already brought you through. The trial. The tribulation. The hardship. He's brought you through them. And he was faithful then. And he will be faithful now. Remember his works. Remember, it helps you believe in his power today. And then third, the testimony of others. I don't know about you, I get fired up. My faith is like soaring high when I hear the testimony of other people, how the power of Christ is working in them through their salvation, through a healing, through something that the Lord has brought them through supernaturally. I get fired up. My faith is increased when I hear other people experience the power of Christ. And so listen, if you have a testimony, if you have a testimony of salvation, if you have a testimony of being healed, of being brought through a season, share that testimony. Share it with people. It is so powerful to those who hear. It increases their faith, hearing about the power of Christ in your life. Your testimony is a powerful thing. Don't keep it to yourself. Share it with anyone who will listen. So when I'm feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, I will seek Jesus. I will have the faith that leads to action by believing in his power. Here's the third thing. I will push through the discouragement that will come and will not fear. I will push through the discouragement that will come and will not fear. Verse 35 says, while he was still speaking, there came from the ruler's house some who said, your daughter is dead. Why trouble the teacher any further? But overhearing what they said, Jesus said to the ruler of the synagogue, do not fear, only believe. That's some discouraging news. Can you imagine how Jairus is feeling in this moment? He was probably feeling pretty impatient, pretty worried, pretty panicked, and pretty afraid as they were being delayed by this encounter with this woman. He's probably thinking, come on, Jesus. Like, we gotta go. She is on the brink of death. She is about to die. We have to hurry up. We have to go right now. We can't stop. And as soon as the miracle is done, as soon as they were finishing their conversation, he receives the news that his daughter is dead. He must have been devastated at this moment, filled with fear and discouragement. And we know that he was distraught and fearful because of what Jesus says to him. Jesus hears what they say and he knows what Jairus is feeling and he tells him, do not fear, only believe. Jesus is calling Jairus to intense faith in this moment. Do not be discouraged. Do not be distraught. Continue to believe in me. And he allowed no one to follow him except Peter and James and John, the brother of James. It's a special note. This is the first instance that we see special privilege for these three disciples being able to witness what is about to happen. They came to the house of the ruler of the synagogue, and Jesus saw a commotion, people weeping and wailing loudly. And when he had entered, he said to them, why are you making a commotion and weeping? The child is not dead, but sleeping. And they laughed. They entered this scene at the house, which would have been pretty common in this time period. People weeping and wailing loudly. These would have been professional mourners. They would have been people hired by the family to wail and to weep and to cry and to scream and to beat their chest in mourning over the loss of this little girl. So Jesus comes in and says, why are you doing all of this? What are you doing? She's not dead, she's sleeping. And they laugh scornfully to humiliate him because Jesus says sleeping. Now, does that mean, Jesus says sleeping, does that mean the girl's not dead? No, she's dead. She's certainly dead. This is figurative speech. Death was a state like sleep, but Jesus had the power to wake her up. This wasn't permanent. Jesus had the power to change what was happening here. And you know, this passage has really challenged me this week, and I hope that it challenges you as well. I find that I let discouragement keep me from greater depths of faith and trust in Jesus far too often. Let me give you an immediate example of this. 2 weeks ago, I shared about my son and his type 1 diabetes, and I shared the prayer that I prayed on January 1st. I prayed for strength, I prayed for steadfastness, and I prayed for peace in the midst of the storm. Since that moment, we've prayed for a cure, that the doctors would come up with one, and that somehow, some way, that would happen in the future. And I was thinking this week as I was reading through this, being challenged by the faith of this woman and this man, Jairus. Why have I never just flat out asked God to heal my son? To do the miracle? Why have I never asked God to do the supernatural? To do the impossible? Why have I never asked him that? It's because of discouragement that leads to fear. I got caught in that. And I'm thankful for God's word this week that challenged and convicted me of this. So I've been praying a pretty big prayer this week and will continue to do so, that God would completely heal my son, that he would completely, supernaturally, immediately heal my son Zion. Regardless of if he does or doesn't, I'm gonna continue to pray that. I'm gonna ask God for big things. And if it's his will, then he's gonna do it. And if it's not his will, then he won't do it. But I don't want to have not because I ask not. I want to pray big prayers. And I would encourage you to do the same. Pray big prayers. Ask God for big things. Ask him to do the impossible. Ask him to do the things that only he can do. Ask him to do the miraculous. Pray big prayers. Do not let discouragement and fear keep you from greater depths of faith and trust in Jesus. Pray the big prayer. Do not fear. Only believe. Pray big prayers. And do not fear. Only believe. When I'm feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, I will seek Jesus. I will have the faith that leads to action by believing in his power. I will push through the discouragement that will come and will not fear, because when I do, no matter the outcome, I will see the power of Christ on full display. But he put them all outside and took the child's father and mother and those who were with him and went in where the child was. Taking her by the hand, he said to her, Talitha kumi, which means little girl, I say to you, arise. And immediately the girl got up and began walking, for she was 12 years of age. And they were immediately overcome with amazement. And he strictly charged them that no one should know this and told them to give her something to eat. Jesus takes her by the hand and speaks directly to the little girl. He says, little girl. He's not speaking to a corpse. He's speaking directly to her. He says, arise, which could be translated, wake up. And here's the word again. Immediately she got up and began walking. She didn't need any time to recover. She didn't need to take a moment and catch her breath. She needed to get up and stretch a little bit before she got walking. She got up immediately and started walking. Why? Because Jesus healed her completely, totally, fully, immediately. Jairus had only asked Jesus to heal her of an illness. But Jesus, in his demonstration of his power and authority, didn't merely heal her from an illness. He raised her from the dead. And they were immediately overcome with amazement, naturally. They had just witnessed the impossible, the miraculous. They were astonished. And then Jesus strictly charges them that no one should know about this. Now, this would be impossible to conceal for a long time. There are many people who knew that this daughter was dead, and now she's alive. They wouldn't be able to conceal this for a long time. And so I think the reason Jesus is saying this is, one, so people wouldn't know until he had left, and two, I think this is a great kindness to this family, to keep it private for as long as possible so that they can have this moment together. Then Jesus continues his kindness by being attentive to her needs. Do you notice how this passage ends? It ends with him telling them to give her something to eat. While they're all caught up in the amazement and the excitement of what just happened, Jesus is thoughtful of the needs of this child. You see, she wouldn't have eaten much leading up to the days of this moment because she was sick. And so she would need food right now. This is Jesus Christ on full display, defeating death one moment and being incredibly thoughtful of the needs of others in the next. Jesus doesn't just have the authority over illness. Jesus doesn't just have authority over disease. Jesus has authority even over death. This is the power of Christ on full display, right here. Death is supposed to be a finality. It's supposed to be the end. Things don't come back from death. But Jesus Christ shows his power and his authority in this moment. What an incredible comfort this is for us. Death is not the end. Why? Because Jesus has all authority over it. That's comforting. I want to close with this. I think it's really important that when we see scriptures like this and we go through scriptures like this, we need to realize that the power of Christ on full display will look differently in every situation. Sometimes the miracle that you were looking for will happen, and sometimes it won't. This scripture right here is not a promise that through faith, as you look to Jesus and believe in his power and overcome discouragement, that tragedy won't still happen. It will. Tragedy will still happen. Even if you pray and fast and have intense faith, your loved one still might pass away. You still may lose your job. You still may have financial troubles. You still may stay uncured of your disease. You still may not be able to restore the relationship. But the power of Christ will still be on full display. I think Paul sums this up perfectly while he is suffering with a thorn in his side. This is kind of my life verse. 2 Corinthians 12:8-10. Three times I pleaded with the Lord about this, that it should leave me. But he said to me, my grace is sufficient for you, for my power is made perfect in weakness. Therefore, I will boast all the more gladly of my weaknesses, so that the power of Christ may rest upon me. For the sake of Christ, then, I am content with weaknesses, insults, hardships, persecutions, and calamities. For when I am weak, then I am strong. His grace is sufficient for you. And even when the miracle doesn't come, the power of Christ is still on full display in your life. I wrote down a couple of ways that we can see that. The first one is the strength that he grants you. The supernatural strength that you are given by the Lord in times of trouble, in times of hardship, in times of calamity. That supernatural strength that carries you through. That is the power of Christ on full display in your life. The comfort that he brings you. He is our refuge. He is our shield. He is our fortress. He is our shepherd. That supernatural comfort that comes with trial, that is given to us by him. That is the power of Christ on full display in your life. The peace that he promises you, Philippians 4:7, and the peace which surpasses all understanding will guard your hearts and your minds in Christ Jesus our Lord. That supernatural peace, that ununderstandable peace, that is the power of Christ on full display in your life. The hope that he gives you. The hope that he gives you. This isn't the end. This isn't it. This is temporary. This is temporal. There is something so much greater at the end. There is eternity with Jesus, where there will be no more sin, no more sadness, no more pain, no more illness, no more death. Amen. Jesus Christ will wipe away every tear. That is the great hope that we have, and that hope is the power of Christ on full display. And then this, the ministry he equips you for. The ministry he equips you for. The trial that you're going through, the struggle, the calamity, the hardship. You being brought through that is, he is giving you a ministry unlike any other. He is giving you a supernatural ministry through those moments to where you can take what the Lord has taught you, what the Lord has showed you, what the Lord has done in you in those moments, and you now have a ministry unlike any other to go to other people who are walking the same path that you have walked. And now you are able to minister to them in a way that no one else could. That ministry that has been given to you, that is the power of Christ on full display in your life. And so even when the miracle doesn't come the way that I think or want, these right here, these five things, these are miracles in of themselves. That is the power of Christ on full display in your life. And so when I'm feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, I will seek Jesus. I will have the faith that leads to action by believing in his power. I will push through the discouragement that will come, and I will not fear, because when I do, no matter the outcome, I will see the power of Christ on full display. Let's pray. God, we come before you right now, Lord. We're thankful for your word. Thank you for these stories of faith, Lord. How they challenge us, how they convict us. Lord, I just want to pray this statement over us right now. Lord, when we are feeling the desperation that comes with crisis, we will seek you. We will have the faith that leads to action by believing in your power. We will push through the discouragement that will come, and we will not fear, because when we do, no matter the outcome, we will see the power of Christ on full display. So Lord, help us. Help us to seek you. Help us to believe in your power. Help us to push through discouragement. Lord, help us to see your power in our life on full display. Lord, thank you for our time together. We pray all of this in Jesus' name. Amen.